Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Shayantan Roy. I am a postgraduate trainee from Nilrakan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital, and I would be presenting my paper based on the evaluation of brain abnormalities in infants with myelomeningocele using magnetic resonance imaging. So, introduction, we see that spinal dysrophism includes a highly heterogeneous group of congenital abnormalities that occur from abnormal closure of the neural tube. Dottori Donati et al. Proposed a simple classification of spinal dysrophism, which was based on clinical findings and MRI findings. The closed form of spinal dysrophism may be asymptomatic, but the open form is usually associated with several disabilities. Myelomeningocele is seen to be the most common type of open spinal dystrophism and occurs from failed closure of the caudal end of the neural tube. There has been a significant worldwide decrease in the number of infants born with myelomeningocele because of improved maternal nutrition along with prenatal diagnostic tests and real-time ultrasonography. However, in those infants being born, depending on the location of the defect, significant neurological deficits might occur, and patients have been found to suffer from lower limb paralysis, sensory loss, along with bladder and bowel dysfunction. Myelomeningocele has been associated with multiple cerebral defects, and these are directly related to intellectual and cognitive functioning. For example, hydrocephalus has been proposed to be the main cause of any cognitive dysfunction that the infant is suffering from. In addition, Wink et al. Had suggested that several other cognitive deficits might be attributed to Arnold Carey malformation, which is seen in cases of myelomeningocele. There are few studies describing the forebrain abnormalities related to myelomeningocele. However, most of these reports are based on autopsy studies, which might be suffering from selection bias towards severe types of malformation. We have evaluated cerebral abnormalities in patients with myelomeningocele, which the study done in children under 6 months of age in our present study. Our aim was to study, our aim of the study was to evaluate the pediatric brain in infants with myelomeningocele and determine the prevalence of various types of cerebral abnormalities in such cases. The materials and methods we used in this study were: the study area was the Department of Radiodiagnosis in our hospital. The study period was from June 2020 to August 2021, and the study population consisted of 22 patients. The inclusion criteria was the patients referred to the radiodiagnosis department with myelomeningocele for the evaluation of their brain, and the exclusion criteria were patients whose guardians did not give consent were excluded from the study. Materials used were: the brain MRI was performed with a 1.5 Tesla GE Sigma HD MRI scanner. The patients underwent T1 weighted, T2 weighted, FLAIR and EWI sequences in axial, sagittal and coronal planes. The diagnostic criteria, before we go into the depth of the study: the Chiari malformation are a group of defects with congenital caudal displacement, one of which is Chiari type 2, which is defined as a displacement of medulla, fourth ventricle and cerebellar foramen into the cervical spinal canal and the presence of a small posterior fossa. Cerebellar hypoplasia was diagnosed when one or both cerebellar hemispheres were small with short but normally arranged fissures without any displacement through the foramen magnum. Brainstem hypoplasia was diagnosed when the brainstem had reduced sagittal dimensions and the anterior curvature of the pons was flattened. Small posterior fossa was diagnosed when the posterior fossa had reduced sagittal dimensions with the corresponding steeply inclined interior. The partial agenesis of the corpus callosum was defined as an absence of a part of the corpus callosum, whereas corpus callosum dysplasia was applied when the morphology of the corpus callosum is altered. Corpocephaly was a descriptive term for the disproportionate prominence of the occipital horns of the lateral ventricle. In the results and analysis, the study consisted of 22 infants, out of which 15 were male and 7 were female. The mean age was 2.5 months. Amongst the supratentorial findings, hydrocephalus was the predominant finding and it was seen in 16 patients. Enlargement of subarachnoid spaces was observed in 4 patients. Total agenesis of the corpus callosum was observed in 3 patients and all of whom had corpocephaly. Partial agenesis was observed in 4 patients and dysplasia of the corpus callosum was seen in 7 patients. A common finding was the presence of wide interhemispheric fissure that was observed in 9 patients. And 5 of them also had corpus callosum abnormalities at the same time. Corpocephaly was observed in 3 patients and 2 patients were found to have polymicrogyria. Heterotopic gray matter was observed in 2 other patients and absence of septum pellucidum was observed in 3 patients. In the infratentorial findings, Chiari type 2 was observed in 15 patients and hypoplasia of the cerebellum was observed in 2 patients, whereas hypoplasia of the brainstem was observed in 5 patients. A small posterior fossa was seen in a significant number, that is 13 patients, and cervical syrinx was seen in 1 patient. Now, discussion. Myelomeningocele was seen to be associated with multiple cerebral defects, as seen in our study. Mostly, however, in previous studies, it was mostly done on autopsy, based on autopsies. However, with the utilization of MRI, only some studies have attempted to evaluate patients of all age groups with myelomeningocele. In our present study, after complete evaluation of cerebral abnormalities in children under 6 months of age, we found a spectrum of cerebral findings. Hydrocephalus was the most common finding, as seen in also previous studies, like Just et al. Had reported that in a case series of 44 patients having myelomeningocele, hydrocephalus was detected in 27 patients. Now, the enlargement of the lateral ventricle might be varied. As a result of this, symmetric and asymmetric dilatation can be observed. We could detect corpocephaly in 13.6% of our patients. Anomalies of neuronal migration, usually causing seizures and developmental retardation, have been reported in association with myelomeningocele. Just et al. Had described this abnormality in 6 out of 44 patients. In the present study, nodules of heterotopic gray matter were seen in 2 patients. Now, interestingly, Hassan et al. Recently studied white matter microstructural abnormalities in children with myelomeningocele by using diffusion traction tensor tractography and found abnormal white matter development and persistent degeneration with increased age relative to control patients. Juranek et al. Studied using total cerebral volumes, neocortical surface area, neocortical thickness in children with myelomeningocele and subsequently reported about 15% reduction in total white matter and 69% increase in cerebrospinal fluid, but with no difference in total gray matter relative to the control group. Additionally, it was found that there can be significantly smaller neocortical surface area, mainly in the occipital regions. Now, polymicrogyria, which is very epileptogenic, has been reported to occur in 33% of patients with myelomeningocele. In our study, we could find it in only 2 patients. Now, absence of septum pellucidum is also highly reported abnormality. It usually occurs along with abnormalities of the corpus callosum. In our study, there were 3 patients with absence of septum pellucidum. Out of this, 2 were found to have concurrent partial agenesis of the corpus callosum. Now, total or partial agenesis of the corpus callosum is seen to be a common finding as well. Just et al. Had reported a frequency of 56% of partial agenesis of corpus callosum, whereas Kawamura had observed partial agenesis in 50% of infants. Concerning infratentorial abnormalities, the best known and the best documented in patients with myelomeningocele is obviously Chiari malformation type 2. Just et al. Had found Chiari malformation in 76% of patients. In our series, we observed Chiari type 2 malformation in 68.2% of our patients. Therefore, the presentation of symptomatic Chiari may vary depending on the child's age. Now, decompression must be performed early for symptomatic Chiari type 2 in order to promote a prompt and full neurological recovery. In 59.1% of our patients, it was found that a small posterior fossa was present. Brain stem and cerebellar hypoplasia were other common findings, and these can result in patients' neurological deterioration. One patient in our study was observed with a cervical syrinx. Just et al. Had reported that syrinx occurred in all sections of the spinal cord, and the size was seen to vary from small circumscribed cavities to large lesions. From our study, we could see that apart from MRI, computed tomography and ultrasonography have also been used as alternative imaging techniques in the previous studies. Nevertheless, computed tomography has the distinct disadvantage of radiation exposure, and ultrasonography is limited in the evaluation of posterior fossa, with lower resolution and operator dependence being a very vital factor in ultrasonography. So with taking all this into consideration, MRI is definitely the imaging procedure of choice. Limitations of our present study were mainly 2 things. First, we did not perform any volumetric measurements that would provide a more accurate characterization of our findings. And secondly, the study focused on structural findings of brain MRI and not the ultimate predicted neurological outcome, which needed follow-up of the patients. Here is the table number 1, which shows MRI abnormalities detected in supratentorial compartment, where we could see that the most common finding is obviously hydrocephalus, seen in 16 patients. Here is table number 2, which shows the MRI brain abnormalities detected in infratentorial compartment, where the most common findings were Chiari malformation type 2, seen in 15 patients. Here are some of the images of the findings seen in our study. This is figure 1, which shows an axial T1 and T2 weighted MRI of 2 different infants showing hydrocephalus. This is figure 2, which shows an axial T1 weighted image of an infant showing absent septum pellucidum. So this is figure 3, an axial T2 weighted image of an infant showing enlargement of the subarachnoid spaces, as seen in this image. In figure number 4, we see a sagittal T1 weighted image of an infant showing complete agenesis of the corpus callosum. There is no corpus callosum seen in this mid-sagittal section. And in figure number 5, axial T1 weighted image of an infant showing nodular periventricular gray matter heterotopia in left lateral ventricle. In figure number 6, there is a sagittal G1-weighted image of an infant showing cerebellar hypoplasia, where the cerebellum is grossly reduced in size. And figure number 7 shows a sagittal T1-weighted image of an infant showing partial agenesis of the corpus callosum with Arnold Carey type 2 malformation seen in the posterior fossa. Now, in conclusion, we can say that brain imaging, especially with MRI at an early age, may be able to detect and characterize these abnormalities which are found to be associated with myelomeningocele, and detection of these abnormalities with proven neurocognitive effects will help to better determine the ultimate prognosis of the infant. These are my references. Thank you.